welcome you to this meeting of the Temple Baptist Church and our Baptist friends. What a meeting God has blessed us with, and we give him the glory, all the glory and praise for that. All the blessings of God, I believe, are in answers to prayer, and we praise the Lord for people who have been praying and asking God to move and work in a mighty way. I thank God for all of our people working so hard, choir, orchestra, instrumentalists, ushers, greeters. If you're a pastor, you know what I'm talking about. You just can't do this without the people of God working hard and giving themselves in this effort. I want you to pray with me and pray for me and pray for those who are speaking in this hour. We've had a marvelous time listening to the preachers God's given us, and we continue to pray for them. This is just the beginning, just the beginning. Let me greet the friends who are joining us by means of radio as we broadcast the services live, and people listen. We've been doing that for 30-something years, and we appreciate that audience of people who love and appreciate what we're doing. And then as we live stream the meetings, many people across the country and around the world in our city are not only hearing but watching, and we invite them to participate as much as they possibly can. We're so glad we can live stream the meeting on faithforthefamily.com and thetemplebaptistchurch.com. Let's stand together, please. We're going to pray, and this is not an exercise in me praying. We're praying together and looking to the Lord. I want you to pray with me, would you please? Our Father, we give thee praise and glory that we have the opportunity to enter in, not on our own merit or what we've earned or done, on the merit of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and what he purchased for us through his death, burial, and resurrection and ascension on high, where he ever lives to make intercession for us. We are confident, Lord, that we can be heard, our prayers can be answered, and we ask for thy blessing upon this meeting, that it'll be taken further than men can take it and any effort of ours can produce. Touch it by thy Spirit. Move mightily in our midst. Bless those who are preaching and singing. Help us, Lord, to be ready to receive from thy good hand to our hearts exactly what you want us to have. We thank thee and praise thee. What a Savior we have. And we give thee all the glory. In Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. I want you to find our crown hymn book, please, and turn with me to a song we love to sing, Grace That Is Greater Than Our Sin, hymn number 255, as we begin the meeting. And this is what we all can agree with and sing with all of our heart. Brother Stephen comes to lead us. Hymn number 255.
Amen. Let's sing it out all together. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord. All together.
Marvelous grace of
our Savior, grace, 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 gr you so much. You may be seated. We're happy to have another one of our children's choirs singing in this hour. And we call these brave boys and girls. And we're praying for them as they sing now. God bless you, children.
Blessing. Amen. Thank you, young people. And that was encouraging tonight. Let's take our hymn books and turn to hymn number 257. Hymn number 257. Let's all stand together and sing this. I found a friend who is all to me, and I'm thankful I'm saved by his power tonight. Let's sing this all together.
I love you.
you so much. All around, you may be seated. We'd like to have a time of prayer together, but first want to make sure you have this bulletin. And we've been trying to get this in everyone's hands, but perhaps you're here in this meeting and do not have it yet. If you'll raise your hand for just a moment, our men will be happy to bring one to you. And I hope you'll keep it with you and pray much. We're trusting that much will come out of this meeting. And among those many good fruits, we trust that a wonderful resurgence and revival of prayer for our nation and for regions of this nation that need the gospel, and a very specific prayer. And that reminds you of it as you look through this special bulletin. So I hope you'll keep it with you. I'd like to share just a number of prayer requests. If you have a pen handy and can write down the names of our folks who have special needs, we would appreciate that. And then Brother Zinker will come and lead us in prayer as we remember them. Please pray for Beverly McBride and the homegoing of her son, Jesse McBride. And we thank God for Jesse's wonderful testimony. We're praying for his mother and family. Please pray for Angela McKinney as she's recovering from surgery. And pray for Doc Carden, who's in the hospital this evening. Pray for Steve Regal. This is Kathleen Regal's son, who is recovering from heart surgery. And please continue to pray for Dan and Amy Baker's daughter, Janelle Misseldine. And she is recovering from brain surgery and has been diagnosed with brain cancer. And we're praying that God will touch her in a very special way. Please continue to pray for Pastor Ryan Marlowe, who's been so very ill, and we're praying for continued improvement in his condition. And then a number of our folks and friends have been battling cancer for some time, and we're continuing to pray for them. Pray for Debbie Mullins and Lisa Orrick, and for Robin Owens and for Beth Holman, and also for Carol Huang and Norma Jean Griffith and for Maria Lee. And as we go to the Lord together, Brother Zinker's coming now to lead us. Let's join our hearts with his, and let's go to the throne of grace together. And let's believe by faith that God can hear and answer these prayers.
May we pray together for these needs this evening. Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee that we can come into Thy presence, that we are welcome to be in Thy throne room because of Christ and all of His work, His shed blood, His merits. We come in His name. We thank Thee that we have an audience with the great God of the universe that made the stars also, that enables us to come and meet in this place and has revealed Thyself to us through Thy word. We're thankful for all of these wonderful blessings. We're grateful for Thy new mercies, for Thy grace to us, Thy kindness to us. And we pray this evening that we would sense Thy presence with us in this meeting. Speak to hearts, give direction and guidance in every way. We pray for those who are lost, that they would come to know Christ as their Savior, even tonight. Bless the preachers. Help us be as listeners who will willingly say yes to whatever the Holy Spirit speaks to us about this evening. We're thankful for this meeting. Bless the church planters around this nation, around the world, as they go forth with the gospel. Encourage them. Lift them up. Give them a token for good. Help them and enable them to have great faith in Thee, for Thou art a great God, and we may expect great things from Thee. We bring before Thee and intercede on behalf of the needs of the people who have been mentioned. We think of Beverly McBride. We pray that she may know Thy grace during the homegoing of her son Jesse. Help her, strengthen her. We're thankful for Jesse's clear testimony. We're thankful that his years-long battle with cancer is now completely healed and he's with Thee in heaven. We're thankful for the promise of eternal life. We pray for others who have gone through surgery and are recovering, and those who are still in the hospital, and we pray that they may know Thy help even tonight. As we are praying, may they sense that Thou art with them, and may the Holy Spirit be that comforter who comes alongside them and gives them all that they need in the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray especially this evening for Janelle Misseldine. We pray that as she is having this treatment for her brain cancer, that it would be successful. Bless the little baby she's carrying. We pray that her life would be extended and the baby's life would be protected. We pray for Pastor Ryan Marlowe as well. Help him, lift him up out of this coma, we pray, that he may fully recover. We pray for Debbie Mullins. We pray that she may know Thy help in these days. Bless her and her family, and may they see Thy grace at work moment by moment as they spend time with her. We pray for Lisa Orrick as well and for Robin Owens. And we pray that they may know that Thou art with them. Lift them up. Give them encouragements. And not only in their health, but in their spirit, may they be blessed and helped. We pray for Carol Huang. What a blessing to see her with us recently. Continue to work in her life. And we pray for Norma Jean Griffith as well. Give them the guidance and help that they need. Strengthen and encourage them. We pray for our governor's wife, Mrs. Lee. We pray that she may know thy help and that she would draw close to thee in this time. We're thankful for all of the good things that we've heard and seen, all the blessings we've experienced and enjoyed. But help us not just be consumers of those things. Help us take those things and may we blaze abroad the truth of Jesus Christ. May this country be affected by this meeting. May this world be affected by things that happen, eternal things that happen in this meeting. And do us good, we ask, and help us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm going to ask our speakers who've been with us during the week to come to the platform with me just for a moment and share just a word from their hearts with all of us so you can continue to pray for them, thank the Lord for them. And so Kendall Wadley and his wife, Adarsha, if you'll come please. Brother Greg Boyle, and if you can get Patty to come, that'll be great. Tim Hawes and Leandra, good. That's wonderful. Derek Moreland, wonderful. And we thank God for all of these folks. I don't want to leave anybody out. So I want our camp directors for the Passage Northwest, Brother Deku and his wife to come up. And James and Gabriella, would you come please and stand here too? And Easton Colbert, would you please come? Derek Moreland's here. Derek's going back tomorrow, God willing. His wife's having a baby. He better get there before that baby's born. Need to pray for him. Very good. Now, I want you to stand over here. You know, don't act like a shy person. It's very difficult to talk about what you need, but I want you to say something. If there's something on your heart you think we can help you with, we want to do that. You see, you may not be able to do everything, but you know some people who can do something. You can tell people about their ministry. Support the work. Ask God to guide them and help them. But every one of these people have been mightily used of God. All of them. And I want them to tell us what they're doing and what a blessing, if any, this meeting has been to them. This meeting. And then share with us a special prayer request. We're going to take a few minutes to do it, so let's just be comfortable. Listen carefully. You may want to write some things down. You have the names here for you in this bulletin, but come, Greg, you're going to be first? Very good. Look here, folks. And when you come up, if your wife is traveling with you, bring her up here with you. Very good. All right, good. God bless you, buddy.
Yes, sir. I just want to say, first of all, my wife doesn't do stairs real well sometimes. That's the reason she didn't come with me. But she's very appreciative of this meeting. We both are. I pastor in Faith Baptist Church in Spokane, Washington. I've been there for 41 years as the pastor. We started back in 1981. This meeting, the meetings here are always a blessing, but not to be too general, in a very specific way. Because of my health concerns over the last couple of years, I have really weighed in my mind, will there be a time where it's right for me at my next birthday? I'll be 70 years old. Will there be a time where it's time to step back and let a younger man take the helm? And Brother Moreland's message last night on hitherto and henceforth just threw a wrench in all of that. And I told him after the meeting, I said, I'm not just telling you it was a good message like we generally tell somebody. That message helped me. It helped me. Gave me a newer focus. And so I appreciate that very, very much. As far as prayer, just pray for our church, the days ahead, the henceforth. In a very specific way, we have done some other things along the way, but we do not have a Bible club in our local public school. We do not have a, we are right a mile and a half off of the campus of Gonzaga University. So for those of you who follow college basketball, you know about Gonzaga. But we're right there. We do not have a college ministry. So those are two things that I feel like God has really dealt with my heart about going back and getting going. Thank you.
The next time you're here, if you haven't started those, I'm not going to invite you.
Okay.
Come on. Good. And you know, when someone says an unbelievable thing, you've been taught how to respond. For instance, if I said to you, I'm 74 years old, your response. Now, he said he's 70. Come on.
This meeting has been an encouragement to my wife and I, and honestly, I say this every year, but this has been one of the best meetings I've been in my time here.
What do you do? Why are you here?
We work at Lake Texoma Baptist Youth Camp, and it's been our joy and privilege, really, and we thank you for the opportunity to be out there. And
how long have you old people been married?
A whole whopping 7 months, and so we're grateful to God for each other, and that the Lord brought us together right in the heart of Texas, and from California, from Florida, just met in the middle, and the Lord ordained that. And we're grateful for what the Lord's doing in Texas, and not just Texas, but the Southwest. And if I could ask you to pray for anything, I would ask you to pray for just the work to advance with the Native Americans. They're literally on our doorstep. We're 30 minutes from the Choctaw Nation headquarters, and we are already in the headquarters of their Boys and Girls Club for the Choctaw Nation, and underneath that are 14 other Boys and Girls Clubs. And our desire and our goal is to be in all of those clubs. And but the thing we need is transportation to get them to the camp and to have, you know, one day we'll have Bible clubs in all of those, but there's one thing we need is laborers. And you can't be in every place, you know, every time, but we need laborers. And we ask that not just people from here, but, you know, pray that God will raise up people in Texas. And it's much like a mission field. We need nationals, and we need people from that area to answer the call of God and to go to their own people and to reach them with the gospel.
Thank you.
And we're grateful for the opportunity to be here.
Amen. All right. Canada.
My name is Kendall Wadley, and this is my wife, Jessica. And we have two children, Gemma and Amaya. I'm the pastor of Near North Baptist Church in North Bay, Ontario, Canada, in Northern Ontario. If you could really pray for, we say laborers, but we're really praying for 100 consecrated, dedicated laborers to reach the entire country. So we're praying that all of Canada is reached, and we work with this place to reach North America and the rest of the world. So it's a real simple request, 100 dedicated laborers.
Very good.
I'm so happy to be here, and every time I come here, I get a spiritual recharge and very encouraged, and I can't wait to go back home and serve the Lord, and thank you so much for praying for us, and pray as we are looking for land to rent for Crown Nepal and build cabins on it. We need $50,000 plus, and please pray that God will provide in a mighty way, and God willing, we want to start a summer camp, and pray that God would work in a mighty way there in Nepal.
Well, tell me this. Tell me about your wife and children, and then when you find the property, you're going to build several buildings, and what will each of those buildings cost? Yes. Just tell us about the wife and babies.
Yes.
Your name is?
Adarsha Gurung, and my wife's name is Rekha Gurung, and we have two boys, Felix, the oldest, he's 3 years old, and Ezra is the youngest, he's 1 year old, and they're not able to come this time with me, but they're back home. My parents are staying with them while I'm gone. And God willing, they'll be able to come with me one day.
Amen.
And we are planning to bring about, build men's dorm, ladies' dorm, and another building for classes and offices, and a place for dining and kitchen and for our family to live in. And so each building would cost about $5,000. The bigger building would cost about $10,000. That's what we've estimated so far. But we need to relocate from the current building, and that would add additional cost to it all. But we believe God will provide. And before this summer, we need to move. And as soon as I get back, we need to get the land and start moving.
Amen. And why don't we receive our offering this evening, and we'll pay for one of those $5,000 buildings. All right?
Thank you.
Good.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Get started. Get after it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good to see you. Praying for you.
My name is Derek Moreland, and I'm married to Juliana. We met here at Crown College. This conference has been very encouraging. Every meeting, every sermon, every song, and I'm thankful to God to be here. Pray with us as the team of missionary church planters in the United Kingdom. We need the power of God upon the people of God in the work of God. So please pray for us. Pray for more laborers. God is opening up doors every week for new church plants in the United Kingdom, but also now into Europe, beginning with the Netherlands, we believe, on from there. Pray also for Camp Victory. We are in need of a larger property. We've run out of space. There are more than 600 people at the property for the 2 weeks of camp, and we are out of space with 6 acres of land. So please pray for that.
And when was the baby? When's the baby due?
November the 2nd, so 2 weeks, just under 2 weeks.
Good.
Tim and Leandro Hall, Surrey and Papua New Guinea. We do church planning, work at Goroka Baptist Bible College, and also have Bible clubs in the public schools. And the conference has been a great help and a blessing to me personally. Some areas in the ministry I've really been praying and seeking the Lord's guidance for, we've gotten clarity on. So praise the Lord for that. Praise the Lord for his guidance and the preaching of his word. We do have one great need. And Kendall said 100 laborers. We need 2 laborers, but we need them now. And we need a teacher, and we need a mechanic and a builder. So please pray with God, with us, that God would do that. Thank you.
We'll pray with you, and we'll do what we can to send somebody from Crown College from Trades and Technology and pay their salary for the semester and see what they can get done. God
yes,
bless
sir.
You.
Thank you, Pastor.
Amen.
Hello, I'm Joel Deku and my wife, Brooke, and our 3 children with us, Daniel, who's enrolled here at Crown College, and then our daughter, Adeline and Bennett. And it's just great to be back with you. I'm the director at the Passage Northwest, and God is doing an amazing work there. And I'm so thankful for Pastor Sexton and Mrs. Sexton and this church and Crown College for the faith that you had to step out and to do this work there. It just thrills my heart. This conference, I'm so grateful to the Lord calling me to be a pioneer worker for him. Already in a place in the middle of the Pacific Ocean in Kiribati, and we're so grateful if you supported us there and prayed for us. And now to be in the Pacific Northwest and just to see God do this. We're launching out by faith in the Grovers to plant a church in Libby, Montana. And if you'll pray, God is working there. Just time would not allow to share all that God is doing to orchestrate these things. But it's the Lord that does it, and we're excited and looking forward to days ahead what God will do.
Got a brand new church plant.
Yes, sir.
Starting in Libby, Montana. And the people to go and lead, Daniel Grover and his wife Lindsay, have a brand new baby.
Yes,
they're
sir.
Ready to go.
They
and
are.
So we've got a whole lot to pray about. How about you, girl?
Yes, if you would just continue to pray, the Lord has opened the door for the first Bible club and a homeschool group, and we're just praying that the Lord will open the doors for us to get into the public school in our area as well.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hello, my name is Easton Colbert. This is my wife, Allie, and we have the wonderful opportunity to belong to this local church here and serve the pastor. I served the Lord in the youth ministry and helped the pastor in a few different ways in that area. We also work with the camp ministry here at Mount Moriah, and we're very thankful for that. And the Lord's been at work, and we're just grateful for what the Lord is doing. This conference has been really encouraging. If you haven't noticed, there's been a recurring theme, it seems like, of the fact that the Lord is able to give us much more. And the Lord is wanting to advance and wants us to advance with him. And so I see a great need in our area, in our public schools, in Bible clubs, and things like that. And so I know the Lord's able to work and continue to do things in our midst, and that's my prayer and heart's desire. So would you pray for us that the Lord will continue to bless and open doors for us?
And Easton, you are working with the Bible clubs.
Yes, sir.
And we now have, what, 48 in the high schools and middle schools.
Yes, sir.
And we have 57 elementary schools, and we're starting tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
In the elementary schools. And that's been a prayer and a vision for a long, long time. I appreciate your faithful work. God bless y'all. Good. We're going to let these folks take their seat. I want you to know them, pray for them. And you folks who work with me here, when I'm giving the whole farm away, you have to help me remember. We've got to send somebody to Kathmandu, Nepal. And we've got to send somebody to Papua New Guinea. And they're coming. They need them there, living there, working. And we'll take care of them like they're working here for that semester. And I'm sure somebody will be knocking the door down soon to tell you who wants to go. Good. We appreciate Jonathan Hibbert. He and his wife are such precious people. And you know, when you have a work like this going on, you need someone who not only knows the music, but knows the Lord, loves the Lord, and has their heart right about the right thing. And he grew up here. And when we were searching for someone to take our college choir and adult choir, he just was very quiet. And then all of a sudden, the Lord said, "How long are you going to be stupid to me?" And said, "The man is here." And so he's doing a great job. We're praying for him. I think the choir is going to sing. God bless you.
I could find
thank you so much. I'd like for you to find your hymn book, if you would, please, and turn to hymn number 390. Number 390, on the happy golden shore where the faithful part no more, when the storms of life are o'er, meet me there. And we enjoy singing this wonderful song about heaven and about our Lord. And many of you are visiting tonight. We're happy you're here. And some of you may be visiting locally, and we're delighted that you're with us. Our men are coming to greet you in just a moment. If you'd like to remain seated for just a moment, they'll be happy to greet you and pass along a few things that we trust will encourage you. But all of you who call the Temple Baptist Church your church home, or you're visiting in this special conference, we'd like for you to stand, if you would, please. And let's sing this hymn as Brother Steve comes back to lead us.
Amen. Let's join our voices and sing this. Hymn number 390, Meet Me There, all together.
ushers are coming forward to receive our offering this evening. And this is a very special offering. As Pastor Sexton mentioned just a moment ago, we're going to be using what is given in this offering to build that first building there in the rooftop of the world in Nepal and to advance the work of Crown Nepal. What a blessing it's been to have Brother Adarsha with us and to hear what God is doing there around, literally around the world, on the opposite side of the world, what God is doing there. And we're also going to take what is given in this offering and help send two laborers to Papua New Guinea and help the Haws there as they've requested. And so you can be a great blessing helping with the airfare, getting those laborers there and back and helping them while they're there. And so we know exactly what is going to be given this evening toward. And so we're very thankful for these opportunities to advance the gospel. I'd like to ask Brother Max Yama, if he would, to come and lead us in prayer in just a moment. He and his wife Maddie and their two children are down in Key West. They were with us for years, and what a great blessing they were in helping our pastor and helping here in the children's ministry. And they felt the call of God to go and help Max's father start a church, the Southernmost Baptist Church in Key West, Florida, the southernmost part of the United States. And we're grateful they're able to be back with us. We miss them. We're praying for them. So he's going to lead us in prayer in just a moment. Let's give generously, because God is a generous God. He's always so good to us, and we can have a part in world evangelism this evening as we give in this offering. Let's pray together. Brother Max, give us a greeting and lead us in prayer.
Well, my family and I are so grateful to have the opportunity to be here for just a few days, and our hearts have been so encouraged. And the truth is that we would not be able to attempt to do anything that we're believing God is going to do in South Florida if it wasn't for this place. And all that is taking place here, and it's so encouraging, and it's so great to see many people that we know and love, and many new faces. And let's go to the Lord in prayer this evening. Our great God in heaven, we love you and thank you that you have counted us worthy to serve you with our lives. We pray that you would do miraculous works in Nepal, in Papua New Guinea, in all of the places that you have spoken to us about through these speakers and the things you've exposed us to this week. We pray, dear God, that you take what is given tonight and multiply it and use it to bring glory to your name and to further the gospel. In Jesus Christ's name we ask these things. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. God bless you. Wonderful. Wonderfully done. Brother Ab Thomas, would you come, please, and assist me here just for a moment? I'm trying to finish my race, as Paul said to the Ephesian elders, and to finish it with joy. With joy. My God has given grace. We praise Him for that. Keeping the joy. I want you to keep it. We've had a joyous meeting, haven't we? I've enjoyed every moment of it. Every moment of it. And very seldom do I get an opportunity just to sit and talk to people like this. And it's been such an encouragement. Ab Thomas and I had the privilege of working for Dr. Lee Robertson years ago. And Ab directed the youth ministry and had the greatest thing going on in the whole world. How many Bible clubs did you have at one time, Ab, in the youth ministry?
We had 40 Bible clubs. We did it in homes, Christian homes, because we couldn't do it in school back then. Right. And we averaged about between 850 and 900 each week, and our teenagers wanted to go them there.
That's pretty amazing. Yeah. And then the big youth meeting you had every Christmas, between Christmas and New Year's.
Mm-hmm. We did that for 18 years, and we invited churches from all over the country to come, and they did, because we had it the day after Christmas, because, you know, once you open your presents, the next day is about the most boring place you've ever been in your life. But they stayed there for 3 days, and we got it up to about 1,400 kids coming there.
That's amazing.
3 days.
It's amazing. Now, I had the opportunity to be at Highland Park and with Dr. Robertson and Ab in the golden era of that, and it was such a blessing. And God bless Ab and his wife Janice with children. They've got a daughter with the Lord now, and but he's got a son who's got a unique ministry. I want you to tell us a little bit about Paul and what we're going to have, because we have him every year in this meeting, and we enjoy hearing him, what he has to say, and especially that he's given himself to God in such a way and lets the Lord use him in spite of everything he may be able to use for an excuse.
Yes, sir.
Talk to us about it. You introduce him for us.
Okay. Thank you so much. It is a great privilege. About 7 years after our three children came, God blessed us with one of the greatest blessings that we could possibly have, a Down syndrome child. And we did everything we could possibly do. We'd never been around children like that, hardly ever. You hardly ever saw any in church or anything. But we did the best we could do in finding out how to train up a child like that. But we just loved him to our heart. Our kids, when I came home, they just they immediately accepted him. They didn't look at him and say, you know, what's wrong with him or anything like that. We accept him as a gift from God. And boy, has he ever been a gift from God. Just go on and on. He graduated from a high school in Milford, Ohio, class of 400. And when he walked across to get the diploma from high school, they had a rule. They said, we got 400 students have to walk across here, so we don't want any applause at all. We'll never get through this thing. And so then it came time for Paul to come across. And when he started across, a lot of the students started clapping, which you weren't supposed to do. And Paul, of course, took a few steps toward the audience and raised his hands, you know, to kind of urge them a little bit more. And and that's the way it's been the rest of his life. But he does love the Lord. He's 39 in age now. He says that's 39 young. He likes to say it that way. But we're trying to use every avenue to let him serve the Lord because he wants to. If you knew our home down in the basement, we have a full basement there, and Paul's made that one of his rooms. And he'll come down and he'll have his little TV thing on with a football game on, watching that. He's got a gospel record going on over here. He's listening to that at the same time, and then he's preaching at the same time. He does that all the time. He'll go to the bathroom and sit there for a half hour preaching and singing, and we're knocking on the door. Are you through yet? No, he's just starting yet. But he loves God, and he goes with us all over the country as we try to train teachers how to teach. He gets up, and he'll lead a chorus to get them going, to start off, just a little simple chorus. And if they're not singing with their heart, he'll stop right there and say, no, 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 you put your heart into this. That's how you do it. And he'll start them over again. But he does so much for us. He loads my van. He unloads the van. He's one of the most organized young men I've ever seen in my life. Mom will come in to start our Friday night pizza that we do, homemade pizza, and he'll have every single thing there that's already in it before she even walks in the kitchen. He has cut up all the different vegetables and things that go in a pizza and all that. He's got it all ready well ahead of time. He is just a joy to our home, and so we try to allow him to do anything he can do for God, and I'm going to continue to do that the rest of my life. And may God help him, and we love him, and I'm sure a lot of you do too. Paul Thomas.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Anthony. Are you done? My man today, dream. Let me dream. God, have you dared to dream a big dream? Your church, I need you to dream a big dream. You dream, big dream for your family. Your church, and he works for children. I love God. God answered my big dream. God, and a big dream for Noah, Joseph, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, the disciple, Peter, Tyler, the many more. That and me, I had a big dream. We are praying for my bar at Bill Matthew Club. We need more churches and we need more children. Bible said, for God to love the Lord, that he gave only begotten Son, that he's an apple, and leaving him will not perish. What does perish mean? He died without God. Joseph prayed without God. Prayed without God. Without God. Without God. Without God. Because his death and burial and resurrection of Jesus can't be saved. God saved my family. Well, we all going to heaven someday. My sister died from my heart. It's still in heaven by now. My first point is dream a big dream. Number two, pray. Some big prayer. Some answer, big prayer. Bible said, hear my prayer, O Lord. We have a great God to answer big prayer and bigger prayer. God is good to me. That means I'm not so bad. I can still dream a big dream. I can still pray the big prayer. I can still be waiting for you to try. God, you need to help in Sunday school, Truth Church, Master Club, and then in training. I am a preacher for God. I lead a song. I am a first-time author of my church. And in my testimony, I can pray. Let me prayer. About that old man. That dream. That's my dad. Young man. Thou, you need vision. That's me. What are you praying for? Let me be. God, when your children pray, let me prayer. Number two, pray, let me prayer. Number three, my point is, it may be praying to these children. We don't have a chance because you love him, he loves you. And the Bible said, tell the children to come into me, forbid them, not steward the kingdom of God. As he said, to allow to return, that was a standing stone of fall. About then, when I was a child, I beat a child. I saw a child, I understood a child's thing. He said, train him, train up a child. That was a turn to the fall. He tell us to allow them to come. Be careful when they come, but you train him. That was a turn children and sons is for. We don't have a chance because can't be saved, Bible says. And now, from the child, that no Holy Spirit was able to make the right God to faith in Christ Jesus. And that's what the church is for. Number three, and may be praying to these children. Ask God to help you. He will. In my testimony, I gotta stay. As you know, with mom, dad. We all have sinned to store of the glory of God. Bible said, for God to love the Lord, he gave the only begotten Son, and that he do ever, and we in him. We're not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. Everybody needs a Savior, and that's there is Jesus Christ. About that, but if he believes not that I am he, that Jesus, he died in your sin. I'm about that, but he's your ever. That's you. That call upon and find the name of the Lord, as dear shall be saved. Have you taught your prayer and ask you to save you right now? Because he's deaf and barrel and when you're ready, he can't save you today. Amen. I love Jesus. I want you to serve Jesus. God, you mean to go in Sunday school and to church. I help dad to train and master up with children. God, let me preach. Which I'm after my church. I'm a teacher too. Teacher had too. I'm doing so. I am children pastor. I'm children camp. And I turn home. I love Jesus, and I hope you to love him too. Keep my heart, oh God, it may be never true. Keep my heart, oh do.
Amen. Paul, God used you.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. I remember when you were born. We ought to have two things happening right now. One, no excuse for not serving the Lord. Amen. Two, all people need the gospel. Amen. Let's have just a time of prayer right now. Find someone to pray with you. Pray that God will use you. Reach, seriously, reach into a group that you're not reaching into with the gospel. Let God use you. Let God use you. Paul, the Lord is using you. Amen. Would you pray right where you are, right where you're sitting? One of you lead in prayer. Ask God to put upon your heart the group that you need to reach. And ask the Lord to help us. No excuses for not giving him all. Father, we know that meetings like this build. And you speak to our hearts. Point us in the right way. Show us exactly what you have for us. Help us, Lord, be specific with us. Make it something we cannot overlook. And help us to follow thy direction with a burden that you put on our heart. Thank you for Paul and for his willingness to be used of thee. For Ab and Janice, and the grace and direction you've given them. In Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And we do this every year. My brother's coming to preach. We thank God for him. I was there when he came to Christ. Some people wonder who's the oldest. I'm 13 months older. 13 months older. My mother says that I used to take his bottle and drink his milk and give it back to him empty. That's why he's in the shape he's in. But I love having him. He's been through a great storm. His house was destroyed. The eye of that hurricane hit right where he lives. 5 feet of water throughout their house. They've been dealing with that. And God is working. People are giving, encouraging. Our people have done over the top trying to help him and encourage him. And so I want him to be able to preach, tell us what's on his heart. First, Chris and Natalie are going to come and sing. This young couple, Natalie is the daughter of the Hibberts who work with us here. Jonathan, who directs the music, sister, and they've surrendered to go to Scotland. They're headed to Scotland, and they believe that's God's place for them. And some of you want to say you need to help them. And they'll get there, and they'll do a great job when they get there. They're going to come and sing, and then Tommy's going to come and speak. God bless you.
Jesus, the name high over all. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless you. It was such a thrill for me to hear Paul and to hear what Ab had to say. I remember also when Paul was born, and I just thank the Lord for all he's been able to do with his life. God gave him to two very precious parents, Ab Thomas and Janice Thomas. Janice Thomas was my English teacher when I was in college. She had quite a challenge on her hands. I remember we first day, she gave us a little bit of a quiz to see what we knew. And she said to me, "Now, Tom, don't worry. A lot of people had to repeat this course a few times." Well, what a wonderful Christian lady. I've never seen her. She wasn't smiling and happy. She's anointed with the oil of gladness, and I do believe that Paul got that from his mother. He got the preaching from his father and teaching. Janice Thomas, she said to me one day, she said, "Tom, you tell the most interesting stories. I'm going to teach you how to write like you speak." Now look, that changed my life. It was revolutionary for me. And I thank God for the time she invested to help me. I had the opportunity to write articles for the evangelist then. I was preaching in a meeting once, many years ago, and she was in the meeting, and she's not able to be with us tonight. And anyway, I looked back and I saw her, and I said, "I just want to thank Janice Thomas, for allowing me to grade my own papers so I could graduate." Oh, she about died. I said, "It's easier to get forgiveness than it is to learn." No, I'm just kidding you. But I do thank the Lord for the people who invested in my life. You know, you start thinking about all the different people, the men and women who dedicated themselves to serve God, who put their life in your life. There's nothing greater than that, nothing greater than investing your life in the future. And one day we'll all be together in heaven. Won't that be exciting? I'm looking forward to that. And I do want to thank all the staff and personnel here at this great church for the kindness and hospitality. I want to tell you, they've just rolled out the red carpet for all of us. And we've felt so welcome and so at home. And it's not only a stirring meeting, but it's been a very refreshing meeting. The fellowship with one another, seeing and hearing what God is doing and how the Lord is working. My goodness, dear brother, keep going and going and going. I love it. I thank God for this church and for all the wonderful people. You know, there are so many on the other side now. I believe they're looking over with a great cloud of witnesses, and I cannot help but believe they're encouraged by all that they see. And one day, if we continue to invest their influence and investment in our lives, we will all rejoice at the judgment seat of Christ. As my brother mentioned, September the 28th, we went through quite a storm in South Florida. Now, if you've never lived in Florida, you enjoy everything about it except when the storms come. And we had this hurricane coming, and all the people who were watching it told us that, don't worry, it's going to Tampa. Now, I felt bad for Tampa, but I felt good for us. And it was way out in the Gulf, and the way they measure these things, it was just no problem. On Sunday, some people asked me about it. I said, well, they've told us it's going to Tampa. We'll get a little bit of rain and a little bit of wind, but nothing really serious because they've forecast the track is going to be Tampa. On Sunday night, they said, well, it looks like it may go to Bradenton, which is a lot south. And then on Monday, they said it's probably going to go to Sarasota. Now, they always say no storm has ever went to Sarasota. And then on Tuesday, they announced it's coming after you. It slowed down to about 5 miles an hour, which is a terrible thing to happen to people when a hurricane of that magnitude, 155-mile-an-hour winds, began to swirl over 130-mile radius. It drained Peace River, took all the water out in the Gulf, and now they tell us there's going to be a water surge of anywhere from 20 to 30 feet that's going to come. And so you've got to leave. Well, it was too late for a lot of people in our county to get out, too late for a lot of people on the islands to get out. And so we don't know exactly what happened. They're not saying yet, but I believe one day we're going to hear some sad news, really sad news, of what actually happened. But we all who live there fear there's been a lot of deaths that we're going to find out about. And we just thank God that we were able to survive it. My wife and I decided we had to leave. They came and told us you got to leave or either put your name and social security number on your forearm so we can identify you. By the way, that's one of the most encouraging ways to leave the neighborhood. So I said to my wife, we got to get out of here. She said, I didn't think it was coming. I said, oh, it's coming. We got to go. So I went in my study. I have three Bibles that are very dear to me. I have one I read on my daily devotion, and one I study out of, and one I preach out of. I took three baggies and put each Bible in one, and that's all I had, a little change of clothes, and she grabbed what she had, and off we went. We said, we'll come back tomorrow and get things we need, you know, we'll take care of it. But by the time we got back, it was all over. That storm lasted and lasted. It was a terrifying thing, horrible thing. And it was hard to imagine knowing and thinking of the people that I knew who had not been able to evacuate, people I knew who were on the islands, and people that I knew that quite possibly would lose their lives. It was unbelievable what happened, and still they're digging out, trying to figure it out. After we got out, and we got out on Thursday, we were not allowed to leave till Thursday morning. The storm lasted all day, Wednesday. And we got to our neighborhood. My neighbor came running out and said, Ms. Sexton, Nancy, please take a deep breath. What you're about to see is going to break your heart. And so it's quite an amazing thing to see all that happen, you know. I thank God my wife she cried and wept. And she said, hey, you know, we'll just continue. I was talking to her this afternoon. She said, look, whatever we do is okay with me. I'm just glad we're still in this thing, you know what I mean? But so many people lost so much more. But while we were going through the storm, I was asking God to help me. And the Lord gave me a verse. I'm going to share that with you tonight. In the book of Psalm, chapter number 62, verse number 8. You know, it's amazing how the Word of God will come to your mind and heart in the middle of something going on. Now imagine being in a house with 150-mile-an-hour winds outside. That's a lot of wind, by the way. And just about everything is rolling down the road, you know. And it just continued and continued and continued. And this verse, I meditated on this verse. God gave me this verse. And I just thought about it and thought about it. I slept with it. My wife and I went sound asleep through the storm. The Bible says in Psalm 62, verse number 8, the Word of God says, "Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us." Trust in Him. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him, for God is a refuge for us. What a powerful verse. I want to speak just for the next few moments on this subject. Trust Him. Just trust Him. You know, God speaks to people. God speaks to us through three ways. First of all, He speaks to us through His Word. I'm so glad God speaks to me through His Word, aren't you? Amen. He wants to speak to us through His Word. The Bible teaches us that the Word of God is a light under our path, and God speaks to us through the Word of God. By the way, if God's not speaking to you through His Word, then, dear friend, you need to get right. Because God wants to speak through His Word. God not only speaks through His Word, but God speaks to us through people, through believers. Sometimes you find out what you need to do from Christians. Sometimes the Word of God is very clear. You see it. Sometimes you get what you need from God's people. The Bible says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." And the Word of God says that we are light. So God speaks to people through the Word of God. God speaks to people through His children. By the way, most of everything that we've learned in our life, we've learned through the Word of God or someone has taught us. But there's another way that God speaks to people. We don't often think about it. But God speaks to people through circumstances. Now, God doesn't bring these storms, but God does allow things to come into our lives. And God speaks to us. I'm reminded of the rich man who died and went to a devil's hell who asked Abraham to send Lazarus back to speak to his five brethren. And Abraham said, "They have Moses, they have the prophets, let them hear them. They've got the Word of God. Moses gave us the first five books of the Bible. And they've got God's people. They'll hear the Word of God and they'll hear God's people." And he said, "No, Father Abraham, if wind went back from the dead, they'd hear." But what he did not understand is not only did God speak to them through the Word of God and through the prophets, but God spoke to them through the loss of a brother. God always speaks through circumstances. I want you to know that God is speaking. He's speaking to people today through circumstances of life. He's speaking through all the things that are taking place in our nation. I want you to know God is speaking. He never stops. The Bible says He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. We sometimes give up if people don't hear what we have to say, and we give up if they don't hear the Word of God, but God never gives up on people. And God continues to speak. He speaks through circumstances. And the Bible says, "Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us." I remember when I trusted the Lord Jesus as my personal Savior. I never will forget it. I think about it sometimes. It's humorous to me. My brother had stayed after me for years. Most of you know my testimony. You've heard me talk about it and heard him talk about it. But my brother got saved when he was 14 years old. Is that right, brother? And got serious about God. Serious. Matter of fact, on the night when the young people were here representing their clubs, there was a young man down here by West High, and I looked at him, and I thought, that looks like my brother when he was in the ninth grade. And I just looked at him, and he was looking around, taking it all in. I wanted to try to get to him before he left and let him know, "You remind me of the pastor of this church." That might have scared him to death. Maybe God didn't want him to know that. My brother got saved when he was 14 years old and surrendered his life and started serving the Lord. And it wanted to get me saved. I didn't want to hear it. My mother remarried, and I moved to Florida. My brother stayed in Tennessee. And my brother prayed for me and prayed for me. And every time he talked to me, I'd just tell him, Clarence, I don't want to hear it. I just don't want to hear it. I've got something else I want to do with my life. If you have a family member that just doesn't want to hear it, you know what I'm talking about? And so he kept praying. And I'll tell you what God did. God kept turning up the circumstances. Boy, pretty soon I discovered that the way of a transgressor truly is hard. And one day he's in Fort Myers, Florida on vacation. He comes down to see the family. And he's on staff at Highland Park Baptist Church. And he preaches in a church that my little girls have been riding the bus to Sunday school. I decided I'm going to go hear him preach. Now, as far as I know, that was the first time I heard him preach. I think I attended a church prior to that that he was preaching, but I must have not paid much attention to it. But anyway, he preached, and that night he introduced me as his one and only brother. By the way, I am his one and only brother. And then he preached on Andrew found his own brother and brought him to Jesus. He said, I'm going to preach on bringing your brother to Jesus. Now, I didn't understand all that. But I began to learn in the middle of that message that he had me as his subject. First time I ever heard him preach, he's preaching on bringing his brother Jesus. I was his object lesson and illustration in the sermon. Every time he said the word brother, bringing your brother to Jesus, they'd turn around and look at me. I was sitting in the back of the auditorium. I thought, oh boy, this is going to be something. And he preached. And he talked about Andrew. Now, I don't think Andrew thought this, but he said, Andrew could picture his brother, Simon Peter, hanging by a thin cord over hell. And I thought about that. I thought, well, if I had a cord, there'd be somebody hanging. It wouldn't be Andrew, and it wouldn't be me. I might just hang him. I did not know you could get up and leave in the middle of a service. I didn't discover that till I started preaching. Hey, where you going? Come back. Get out back in here. We've had enough of you. I thought you had to sit to the last amen. Thank goodness I did. I sit there to the last amen. And I'll tell you something, I'll never forget it. I'll never forget it. He preached that night the gospel as clear as anyone could ever preach it. He preached that Jesus loved me and died for me. Paid my sin debt in full. Then he led it in a sinner's prayer. I bowed my head and prayed and asked God to save me that night. Wow. I trusted him. My life has never been the same since that day. I thank God for a faithful preacher. And I thank God for a brother who loves his brother and wanted to get him saved. By the way, I wouldn't want to go to heaven without my family. I hope you feel that way. I began this journey by trusting God. It wasn't long till God began to work in my life, and I knew that God had something else for me. I wanted to find out what it was. My wife and I had surrendered to the Lord, and we said, hey, whatever he has, we're in on it. And so I learned to trust him. You know, it's one thing to trust him when you're beginning a journey and you're excited about all the things and you're meeting people and everything's new, but I want you to know something. You can trust him at all times. You can trust him when things are going good and you can trust him when things are going bad. I want you to know tonight that you can trust God in the middle of a terrible storm. You can lay your head down at night and have peace that you're in God's hands. There's a verse in the Bible in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 18. The Bible says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Amen. I want you to know I was laying there and I was thinking, I'm trusting God. We're trusting God. We're just trusting him. And then God brought this verse to my mind. In everything give thanks. In everything. Now that verse has an interesting word in it. It doesn't say after everything. It says in everything give thanks. We love to thank God after everything, don't we? I can stand here today and say, boy, I thank God I got through that storm. It's one thing to thank God after something. It's another to thank God in the middle of it. I want you to know something. Our nation is headed for a storm. Not just a storm like we went through, a far worse storm than that. Our nation is headed toward a storm that's going to destroy so much of what we hold dear. Now get ready. The storm's coming. We know that we're living in a very interesting day. God has given us a great opportunity. The storm is coming. And I want you to know something tonight. You're going to have something to hold on to. You have to trust something. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him, for God is a refuge for us. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. How in the world can you thank God in everything? In everything. Well, one reason you can is because we're kept by the power of God. You know, the Bible says in John chapter 10, Jesus said, my Father which gave them to me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Amen. Isn't it wonderful to be in the hand of God? Yes. Boy, I can picture my mind. I know my brother can too, and Brother Ab and others who knew Dr. Robertson can picture in our mind him holding up that godly hand. There was just something about it. He'd hold up that hand. Talk about being in God's hand. Being in God's hand. Now, I'll tell you, when you're in the middle of a storm, when things are happening in your life that you cannot believe is happening, when things come out of nowhere, I want you to know this. In everything, you can thank God. Because you're in God's hand. And nothing can touch you unless God allows it to touch you. Isn't that amazing? No man can pluck them out of hand. So you're going through these fires. You're going through these troubles. Not just a storm like that. But you go through troubles. Medical problems. All kinds of trouble. Family problems. Church problems. And you think, how in the world is this happening? How am I going to get through this? Just realize this, that you're kept by the power of God and nothing can touch you unless a loving Father allows it to touch your life. We also know that whatever touches our life has a greater purpose than we see when it's happening. You know, the Bible says in Romans 8:28, for we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to His purpose. We know. Now, we may not know it right now, but if we can in everything thank God, we will one day see it. We know that all things work together for good. No matter what comes into your life, no matter where you are, whether you're on a mission field or whether you're in America or whether you're in South Florida, wherever, you can know this, that God has you in His hand if you're a child of God. Nothing will ever touch you unless a loving Father allows it. And whatever touches your life has a greater purpose than you first see. In order to find that purpose, you must in everything give thanks. That's the secret. Because there's always a greater purpose. One of my favorite events in the Lord Jesus' earthly ministry is when Lazarus was sick and Mary and Martha sent someone to get Jesus. The Bible tells us in John chapter 11 that Lazarus was so sick they thought he's going to die. In other words, something came into their life they couldn't take care of. You know, a lot of things come into our life and we can figure out how to get out of it. But if you live long enough, something's going to come into your life you can't figure your way out. If you live long enough, you're going to have some things come into your life that only God can help you do. And that's what happened. Lazarus was sick, nigh unto death. They sent for Jesus in John chapter 11. And when they came and told Jesus, they said, "He whom thou lovest," I like that, don't you? "He whom thou lovest is sick." And Jesus said in John chapter 11, verse number 4, when Jesus heard that, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God." The Bible says in verse number 5, "And Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And when he heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place." That's unusual. He said, "This sickness is not unto death, but it's for the glory of God." And the Bible says he loved Martha, he loved Mary, and he certainly loved Lazarus, but he didn't leave and go to him. The Bible says he abode there still 2 days. Now, you know the story. Lazarus didn't get any better. Lazarus died. Then Jesus said to the disciples an interesting thing. He said to the disciples, "I'm glad for your sake I wasn't there." Can you imagine that? Now, remember, Jesus said there's a greater purpose than Lazarus' sickness. There's a greater thing. This sickness is not unto death, but it is for the glory of God. Then he stayed there. After Lazarus was dead and buried, Jesus goes to Bethany. But he didn't go into the city. He was outside the city. And when it was noised that he was there, Martha got up and ran out to meet Jesus. And Martha said to the Lord Jesus, "If you were here, my brother would not have died." And Jesus said to her, "Thy brother shall rise again." And by the way, Jesus answered Job's question. He'd been waiting a long time. Jesus said unto her, "I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." Job said, "If a man dies, shall he live again?" God didn't answer that. But he did in this verse. You asked the wrong question. Christians don't die. By the way, isn't it wonderful Christians never die? Have you ever thought about it? You're not going to die. You're going to leave this world and step in the presence of God. Jesus said you won't even see death. You won't taste death. To be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. And Jesus said, "Your brother's going to live again." And she said, "I know. In the resurrection." He said, "No, I am the resurrection." Then he said in verse number 27, now watch this. She said unto him, "Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world." Then she went to get Mary. Now this is interesting. She went up to Mary. Mary didn't get up and run with Martha to go meet Jesus. Mary stayed in Bethany in the house. Many of the Jews from Bethany had come into their home and was comforting them because their brother died and was buried. Remember, Jesus said, "The sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God." When it was heard that Jesus was there, Martha ran to meet him. But Mary didn't come. And then the Bible says that Martha went to find Mary, and here's what she said: "The Master is come and calleth for thee." We ought to mark that in your Bible. I pray God would speak to people, let you know he's come. He's calling for you. There's something he wants you to do. Now, why did Mary not go? I don't know. Some believe because she was disappointed with Jesus. You ever been disappointed with the way God did things? Now, come on. Have you ever been disappointed that God didn't just snap his fingers and fix your problem? Have you ever been disappointed that you just didn't get well right away? Have you ever been disappointed that God didn't meet your needs and it just kept getting worse and worse? In other words, have you ever been disappointed with God? And the reason we get disappointed with God is because we don't see the greater purpose that God is doing. And remember, you're supposed to trust him at all times. And so Mary goes out to meet Jesus. now she gets some things right. They go back to Bethany. And the Lord Jesus asked him where they placed him. Of course, he knew where it was. He goes to the tomb and he says, roll away the stone. He said, by now he stinketh. And he said this, said I not unto thee, if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldst see the glory of God. Do you want to see God do something? This sickness is not unto death, but it's for the glory of God. Do you really want to see God do something glorious in your life? Somebody said, hey, all these things are just things. You can replace it. By the way, people who have lost everything are not the ones that say that stuff. And I said, I'm not looking for a replacement. I'm looking for amazing, glorious. By the way, I'm not looking for a replacement body when Jesus comes. I want a glorious body. Amen. God wants to do amazing things. He wants to take us to another level in our faith. He wants us to believe that something good can come out. It never happens unless you're willing to say yes in the storm, in the heartache, in the trial. Now watch. When Jesus spoke and said, Lazarus, come forth, the Bible says that he came out of the grave. Jesus said, loose him, let him go. But look at verse 45 of John chapter 11. This, dear friend, is the greater purpose that Jesus wanted Mary and Martha to see. The Bible says, when Lazarus came out of the grave, then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did. What's those next three words? Believe. Say it loud. Is it? What is it?
Believed on him.
Believed on him. Believed on him. You know, it was an amazing thing happened. We just tried to keep our life right, not get bitter with God, not get disappointed with God, not ask God, why me? And I'm so glad my wife didn't do that. And just say, thank God we're alive. What is God doing? An amazing thing happened. People, my neighbors. Well, first of all, let me say, we had so many wonderful Christians come to help us from around our state. We thank God some folk from here came. But my neighbors, I've tried to be a witness to my neighbors. And they weren't so interested in the things of God. Matter of fact, we didn't even get invited to the Christmas parties after the celebration really began. We could come early and then we'd leave. But you know what happened? Several of my neighbors got saved. They couldn't believe what God had done. They met some of the people that came. We had people in our community, in our city, get saved. There was a movement of God, and still to this day, there's a movement of God in our city. God's got everybody's attention. By the way, we're co-laborers with God. While we're trying to figure out what to do, he can take anything and use it and get people's attention. Aren't you glad God can do that? Now look, the secret of the whole thing is we have to believe. We have to trust God, not after everything is over, but in the middle of it. I can't imagine that I'm at this stage of my life. I said to someone privately, it's hard for me to get my mind around at this stage of my life and ministry that this is what I'm doing now. That's shocking. But I'm so glad that God has given us an opportunity to witness to our city. Our people, God love them. They met at church and they all loaded up on gospel tracts. And we print a lot of tracts and they started sharing their faith. I started getting phone calls from people. They said, I led my neighbor to the Lord. We had one guy call me and said, I've had 11 people saved in this storm. Now look, the storm is coming. The storm is coming. It may not be a hurricane, but the the storm is coming to America. And God's going to come through. God's going to come through in the middle of that storm, whatever it is. He's going to find some Christians who are believing and trusting him at all times, that will pour their heart out to him, that he can become their strength. And God's going to show us what he can do in the middle of all that's taking place. I believe that with all of my heart. I believe God has helped me get a measure of understanding about how to reach people. And look, it's coming. We're going to have a chance to start churches. We're going to have a chance to witness to our neighbors. Now, I don't know what's in it, what it is, but it's coming. It's coming. All that's happening in this nation can't continue to happen without something terrible taking place. And it's coming. It's coming. And when it comes, be ready. God is on the throne. Hallelujah for that. I was laying there, and I remembered the last letter, dear brother, that Dr. Robertson wrote when he wrote the last letter. And he wrote to all of his friends. And in that letter, he said, he made a statement. He said, carry on in the great work that I've given you. Carry on. That touched my heart when I heard that. I wrote a little song called Carry On. Is Jonathan, where did Jonathan go? Well, there he is. He flew the coop. Come on, buddy. I'll sing a verse of it. Carry on. Carry on. Dr. Robertson was such a wonderful encourager. That letter means so much to me. I think if you received it, it means a lot to you. Just a little tune that helps me understand that we have a responsibility to carry on. In Christ we are more than conquerors. In him every battle is won. So carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. Carry on in the faith once delivered. Carry on in the spirit of one. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. Rulers of darkness are making advancements. Lying ahead are the souls of lost men. Very soon the battle will be raging, with his power and the gospel will win. Carry on in the faith once delivered. Carry on in the spirit of one. Carry on in the world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. As we travel toward heaven's bright city, many trials and troubles abound. Oh, but one day we'll stand in his presence. In the morning when the trumpet shall sound, of faith once delivered. Carry on in the spirit of one accord. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. There'll be a wedding in that golden city, in heaven where the saints now abide. So get ready, we're going up in the rapture. When the Father says, son, go get your bride. Carry on in the faith once delivered. Carry on in the spirit of one accord. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. God's given us a great opportunity. This is our moment. God bless you.
God really used him to speak to my heart. I want to ask Jonathan to play that tune that y'all came up with there. And I wonder, if you really know and really believe that the crisis is coming. We won't be pleading with people to do something for God. The people who really know him and love him are going to be launching into the battle, in the fight. We'll know it's our time, our place. We're trying to prepare ourselves and prepare as many people as we possibly can. We've put an emphasis in this meeting on evangelizing the small towns of America. And the fact of the matter is, there's coming a moment, a time, a crisis in our nation where people will know, I've got to go in this town and give people the gospel. What we fail to be motivated to do, we'll be motivated. Are you ready for it? What about your children, your grandchildren? You know, the strangest thing in the world, I'd give anything to pass my faith on, the reality of God on, to people I love. I would really give anything in the world if I could just flip a switch, say a word, and they have it. When I got saved, it meant everything to me. I was the only person in my home who knew the Lord. Years and years and years, I worked on it. God gave me grace. And I'm going to tell you something. I didn't have to be motivated. What the Lord had done for me and in me, I wanted them so desperately to have it too. I just believe there's some people, many people, who need to come and find a place in this altar. We don't play fun and games here. It's an altar. It's a dying place. say, Lord, I've spent a lifetime trying to think, what can I do to get them to do? What can I do to lead them? Just prepare them. The circumstances are coming. There's no doubt about that. We see little inklings of that when a visit to the doctor's office turns into tragedy, or some emergency happens and they're rushed to the hospital. What about when the nation, the neighborhoods, are going to be hit? And it's going to happen. I certainly don't want anybody to live like that every day. But that's what we're here for, prepare people for that moment. Is God speaking to your heart? To find a place to pray and say, Lord, make me strong, help me. Help me. Just leave your place and come. You've heard the message. You've been in the meeting. It might be your son or daughter you're praying for, your grandson. Might be your mother, father. I prayed for my mother's salvation. Then my brother got saved, sisters got saved, and we all prayed for my mother's salvation. She got saved. She got cancer, terrible cancer that was used of the Lord to awaken her senses to the fact she needed to be saved. She never wanted to talk about dying. She just had to talk about it. The doctor said, you've only got months to live. And everything we worked at and tried to talk her into, God used the circumstances to speak to her heart. I don't want that to happen to anybody. You don't either. God is speaking to you. Let's be a prepared people so that when the circumstances God allows comes, we can be strong in the Lord and do something about it. How many have ever yearned in your heart, longed in your heart for somebody to be saved that you loved? You stayed after. Would you raise your hand? We've got to have that again. How many of you have someone that you love is either away from God or give no evidence of being saved, but they will face a circumstance to bring them to the end of themselves? How many of you have someone like that? Join us in this prayer. Leave your place and join us in this prayer. Pray for them. This is a Holy Ghost moment. I mean by that when the Spirit of God is moving. Jump in on it. Don't let it pass by. Of course, I never heard this song. Tommy's always writing poems or songs. And God didn't give me that gift. Who among us, someone older now, who among us has gotten direction from the Lord on a place? Somebody just told me coming in here that God wanted him to go, and they gave me the name of the country. How many of you have gotten some real word from the Lord about specific things and directions for your life? Would you raise your hand? Amen. Settle it. Nail it down. You've been so patient. I appreciate it so much. I'm grateful for all of you being here. Peter Folger is one of our graduates. He's a young man. He's pastoring the Cleveland Baptist Church, married to a lovely girl. They've got a beautiful family. And he and Sandra are with us. I'm glad he was here this meeting. Peter, make your way down the aisle and come lead us in our prayer. And let's pray with these people while they're still here. Carry on. I remember that letter. Dr. Robertson felt impressed of God to write it. It was an open letter to his friends. He was reaching the end of the journey. So, find someone in the altar near you that's appropriate to pray with. Let's ask God to seal all this in this meeting. Do it in the audience. Peter, glad you're here. Pray for you and your family. We're still trying to be what you saw when you were here. Lead us in our prayer, will you?
Father, it's been good for us to take a little bit of time this week to have come to this place that is so meaningful in our lives, and to see that things are still continuing as they always have, how that rejoices our heart. And Lord, we do thank you for the privilege that is ours to be involved in your work. Lord, we understand as we look at our own selves how insufficient we are for the task that is at hand. We're reminded of what the Bible says in 1 John chapter number 4, which teaches us that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The world is mighty powerful. It's influencing a great many things, but we're reminded that you're greater. And Lord, we do pray for these that are here at this altar here tonight and others that are still in their pews praying along with us. Lord, we pray that what was done here this week will not soon die in our hearts, and that there will be a great thrust from this place into and throughout this world. We're praying that churches would be established and that souls would be saved. And we're praying, Lord, that you'd send revival in this late hour. We thank you for the Temple Baptist Church. We thank you for the Crown College and all of the ministries that are associated with them. Lord, how they're touching our world today. We give you honor and praise and glory for all of these things. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Listen, my wife and I love you. We thank God for you putting up with us. And we're doing exactly what the Lord wants us to do. Some of you have got to go get your babies. Please don't leave them there too long. And I need to get these nursery workers to work another day sometime. But I think I'm going to ask old Tom to go over to the piano with a microphone and Jonathan play it through. And some of you want to come up around the piano like the old time way. Dr. Hudson used to get so happy in the Lord. He went to heaven when he was 60 years old, didn't live a long life. But when God had really moved, he liked to sing. And pick up a microphone there that works. Some of you want to just leave your place. You don't have kids you're leaving down there with somebody or something like you don't have to get out of here. It doesn't make a difference who you are. Why don't you come around the piano and we'll sing that through. You teach us that song. Good. Thank you. You've been wonderful to be here for the meeting. It has been so spiritually refreshing. Just what the Holy Spirit ordered for us. And I appreciate so much the faithfulness of everyone. God bless you. Thank you. You're dismissed to go. If somebody want to come over here, go ahead and play a little, Jonathan. Join in over here.
Carry on in the faith. hearts delivered. Carry on in the spirit of one accord. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. Carry on once delivered, carry on in the spirit of one accord. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. Thank you, got it? One more time, here we go. Carry on in the faith once delivered. Carry on in the spirit of one accord. Carry on to a world that is waiting, holding up the crucified one. God bless you. You won't do...